So without further waiting, let us start this masterclass. As all of you know, blockchain is amongst one of the most discussed technology across the globe. Whether you're a part of a very large multinational company or a startup, whether your area of focus is policy making or academics, or whether you are a CEO of a company or a student in an engineering college or a management college, we all have come across discussions around blockchain many times. Surely blockchain is a technology which, when we compare to internet and its impact on the world, might end up in long run having far bigger impact than even internet itself. While blockchain can be used in various scenarios across various industries and domains, I strongly believe some of the most important use cases of blockchain is in agriculture and food domain. And that was the reason to stitch up this masterclass. We would be having four sessions under blockchain in agriculture and food masterclass series. Each of these sessions would be touching upon one critical aspect of application of blockchain in agriculture and food domain. Today's session is about one of such important aspects, that is food safety. So the session one, which is make food safer, will touch upon the areas in which blockchain can play a vital role in ensuring food we eat is safe. Before we go further in our journey to explore this topic, let me give you a little bit of more insight about the speaker, which is me. So I love to call myself a farmer and a serial ag techpreneur. A farmer because we do till land, we do cultivation, ag techpreneur because I founded some of very interesting startups which connected technology to agriculture. My first edtech startup, which was Microbe, tried to solve problem of agriculture input supply chain, making it more efficient for the producers while ensuring relevance and better results at an economical price for the farmers. Similarly, my second startup, Digi Agri, was focused to ensure farmers are able to produce more with less, less of water, less of inputs, and are able to get fair price for their produce. Currently, I am representing Honeybee as a managing consultant. Honeybee is a niche management consulting company which works with technology companies on one hand and producers, which include corporate farming companies as well as small marginal farmers on the other. I was honored as a technology pioneer by the World Economic Forum in 2018. And since then, I have been part of various expert panels and member of World Economic Forum. I was also among the top 10 global agripreneur by Future Agro Challenge, which was supported by various multilateral agencies and the government of Greece. Other awards include being among top 100 social entrepreneur by DBS Foundation and National University of Singapore, as well as NASSCOM Award for using AI for good. I'm a published author of 7 books on technology and business. And last, not the least, I'm a serial technopreneur with more than 20 years of experience across 34 different countries. So now let's get to that subject in hand. So let us understand the typical value chain of agriculture. We have divided that in 2 eras, pre-Green Revolution and post-Green Revolution. So till 1960s, typically farmer used to do farming using inputs like seeds, animal waste, farm waste, water, and human labor. And post-harvest, the typical activities they used to do were manual cleaning, and resources used for that were typically gunny bags and silos. For distribution and sales, predominantly their reach for perishables were domestic and local markets. While for non-perishables, it used to be local, domestic, as well as some part of their produce was exported. And developed countries from Europe and North America were predominantly exporters, and developing countries in Africa and South Southeast Asia were predominant importers. Post-Green Revolution, things became a little bit more complex. So farmers started using certified seeds, hybrid seeds, fertilizers, crop protection chemicals, and mechanization was introduced. All this increased their cost of cultivation for sure. Even post-harvest, the activities became more complex. Now the activities were drying, cleaning, sorting, aggregation, and even conversion. So as activities were more complex, the resources used also became costlier, as well as critical in ensuring that their produce can get better prices. So they started using treated gunny bags, polythene bags. The chemical treatment was done to the output. They required cold storages and better transportation, including the climate controlled transportation. This led to enhancement of their reach, because now both perishable and non-perishables found global markets. So today we can find in one of our supermarkets a kiwi coming all the way from New Zealand, an almond coming from United States of America, and saffron coming all the way from Iran. Post-Green Revolution, the agriculture and food value chain has evolved continuously. During COVID, we have found that these complex value chains are also creating a lot of new emerging challenges, which we need to solve today. Another big picture emerging out of agriculture is that we are having a deluge of data. Data which includes agronomic data, supply chain information, lot of geotech contextual data, data coming from sensors. Now, all this data is definitely revolutionary for small holders, as it has potential to remove the current information asymmetry which we see between large corporate producers and small and marginal farmers. However, whenever we embark on journey of digitization of agriculture data, we need to cut the noise from the value. So whether we talk about a blockchain or a artificial intelligence or machine learning or IoT, we need to answer why before how. And that is fundamental when we discuss the value and impact of blockchain on agriculture and food sector as well. So typically, we are seeing four technology megatrends which are shaping the current and will shape the future of food and agriculture sector. These four megatrends are big data, because as I explained to you earlier, our farms, our food value chains are generating far more data than they used to in past. Second is blockchain. We will delve deep into that going forward. Artificial intelligence and machine learning is another area where, because we are collecting so much of data, creating valuable insight in a contextual manner, where it can be used to autonomously solve some of the inherent challenges of agriculture, is now also visible on the horizon. And finally, the fourth megatrend is Internet of Things. With sensors from mechanization tools to sensors on ground, on plants, on food packets, all of them can play a vital role in giving real-time view of what's happening across different sections of food and agriculture value chains. So now let's talk about the elephant in the room. And according to me, blockchain is the biggest technology megatrend in respect to the four megatrends we talked about. So first of all, it is very important for us to understand that blockchain is not Bitcoin. Unfortunately, whenever we talk about blockchain, people talk about cryptocurrency. Definitely, cryptocurrency is one of the strongest use cases of blockchain, because it ensures transaction between two parties can happen at a fraction of the cost of current centralized banking system. We always say blockchain is a new technology, but that's a wrong assumption because Bitcoin, which is a use case of blockchain, has been there for more than 10 years. Except a couple of hiccups, where a huge chunk of Bitcoins were lost because of various frauds. Other than that, you'll find that Bitcoin has been a very robust product, which is being dealt across the world, which shows how robust the blockchain technology in itself is. Even the Satoshi, who was the person who wrote this paper and was considered as father of Bitcoin, would not have realized that technology, what he is talking about, would be having such an enormous impact on the society going forward. While Bitcoin was developed as a cryptocurrency and was an alternative to fiat currency like dollar, euro, pound, INR, an anonymous bank on the internet, the strong point about Bitcoin was, first, it was creating a decentralization, taking power out from a central force. Second, by using cryptography, it was ensuring that all the transactions are safe and secured. Third, by taking payment and transaction to an immutable ledger system, it ensured that the trust can be digitized. And all these beautiful functions or features of Bitcoin emerges out of it being based on a blockchain. So typically, blockchain is the infrastructure upon which cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin rests. In fact, every 10 minutes, a new block is added by miners on the Bitcoin blockchain. So this gives you understanding that how strongly deep-rooted and well-tested technology blockchain is. So let us understand a little bit about how blockchain works. So there would be multiple people who would be part of a blockchain network using applications and the gateways, where they would request a transaction. Now, this requested transaction by one of the network participants would be broadcasted across the network on a peer-to-peer basis. All the nodes would receive this broadcast. The validity of this transaction is enforced by a private key of someone who is requesting the transaction. Now, as soon as this transaction is broadcasted on the network, it needs to be validated. And the validation of this transaction is done by other network nodes using mathematical algorithms. And this whole process is known as mining. Those who are validating this transaction, they will get some part of incentive for doing the validation. Once the transaction is validated, now these transactions can be of various different mediums. It can be a cryptocurrency, it can be a smart contract, it can be a record, or any other information which someone want to put on the blockchain. Now, once verified, the transaction is combined by the other transaction to create a new block of data on blockchain. Now, this new block which is added to the blockchain is associated through hashtags to a previous transaction, which ensure that this transaction, which has become part of this distributed ledger called blockchain, is permanent and unalterable. And this is where the transaction is completed. Now, as I was telling you that the blockchain is a peer-to-peer encrypted form of database, a distributed ledger, and it is distributed across multiple networks. Everybody who is part of this network will have a copy of this database. It is auto-synced, so all the copy which is on the network are almost instantly synced. All the exchange happen in an encrypted manner. So to create block, validate, you need private keys, and to access public keys. Every piece of data added to this database is immutable, that it can't be deleted or altered. Now, based on configuration, it can be open and public, just like Bitcoin. However, in some cases, it can be created for a closed group, typically in enterprise scenario. The validation happens on a consensus basis, which ensures only there is one version of truth. So as you see in the diagram, that block 51 is connected to block 52. And similarly, block 52 is connected with block 53. This ensures that any manipulation cannot happen. Now, typically, what are blockchain configurations? The blockchain configurations typically can be described in four manner. The first one is permission private distributed ledger, where the broadcasting transaction is limited to a predefined set of nodes. That means it is private. Validating and writing of transaction is granted by a central authority to a predefined set of nodes. So it is permissioned. Permission public distributed ledgers. Any node that runs the right software can broadcast the transaction, so that is public. And the validation and writing of transaction is granted by a central authority to a predefined set of nodes. That means it is permissioned. The third configuration is permissionless private distributed ledgers, where the broadcasting transaction is limited to a predefined set of nodes. While any node can validate and write transaction within the used consensus mechanism, that makes it permissionless. Now, the most open of all, which is the fourth one typically used in Bitcoin sort of scenario, permissionless public distributed ledgers. So any node that runs the right software can broadcast the transaction, making it public, and any node can validate and write transaction within the used consensus mechanism. Now, when we talk about blockchain's application in agriculture, predominantly you'll find that It can be used for IoT and open data. It can be used for farm monitoring and management, trade and supply chain optimization, as well as trust formation, payment and transactions, subsidy and incentive management, compliance and certification. So as you know that we'll be doing 4 sessions in this masterclass, where we'll be discussing 4 different use cases. The food safety, which we are discussing today. The idea is to ensure the food to plate is grown sustainably and is traced end to end from farm to farm to gate, farm gate to fork. Remove counterfeits when it comes to agri input value chains. Risk mitigation by employing insurance and financial products in environment of trust. And finally, the data monetization, how to ensure that the farmer's data can be converted into real value. So farmer doesn't just make money from his produce, but also from the data of activities they are doing. So let's talk about food safety and security. Now it's a big global challenge. Today, more than 821 million people go to bed without 2 square meals. We would be adding close to 2 billion more people by 2050. That means we would be requiring at least 60 to 70% of more food than what we are cultivating today. But the unfortunate reality is that 30% of food we produce goes to waste due to inefficient value chains, which cost us close to $1 trillion. Contaminated food causes 200 plus diseases. 700 million people fall ill every year because of bad food, and close to 500,000 die because of unsafe food. The cost of unsafe food due to medical expenses and productivity losses is close to $200 billion as per the World Bank figures. The food fraud, which includes wrong certificate of origin to the wrong products and outright lies on the label, is close to $100 billion industry today. So we have talked about the symptoms. Let's understand the diagnosis. For that, we'll have to understand the intrinsic challenges and problems of food value chains. First, the food safety measures always add dollars and hours from getting the lab results, ensuring quality checks. All of that means more cost and more time consumed. Secondly, more complex the value chain needs more paper trail. So when you are shipping a product all the way from Mexico to India, there is a huge amount of paper trail and paper contracts, which move along with your produce. While you are selling the produce to the next door neighbor, there is hardly any paperwork. The third is quality assessment at different stages, whether you are at the farm gate or whether you are at the stage where the containers are loaded or where the containers are unloaded and to the end user. The quality assessment at different stage is very difficult. Tracing the source of contamination. So in case the lettuce you have sent all the way to Europe, if it has some contamination, now to check in the next batches if that contamination exists, it's both difficult and costly proposition. The logistic can be a critical spoiler, especially for perishable, because they need conditioned containers to move the produce. And you are not always sure that the optimal environmental conditions are maintained all across the journey of the produce. And finally, it is difficult to regulate and enforce compliance. Each jurisdiction have its own rules and regulations for food product, because food is one of the most regulated industry. Now, if you have not got a comma full stop correctly, that can lead to a lot of challenges, which could be holding up the containers for days, leading to both commercial as well as logistical nightmare for those involved in that trade. Now, how the food value chain can utilize blockchain and why they should utilize blockchain? For that, we have to understand 4 aspects of blockchain. The first being traceability. The beauty of blockchain is that if you are having data associated from the farm, the field, the first level aggregator, the wholesale aggregator, those who are assessing quality, the quality labs or quality individuals, the trader, the food processor, the food retailer, and finally, the consumer. If you put all of them on a blockchain, you'll be able to create trust, and that trust can ensure that you can reduce the cost by making value chains more efficient. Second aspect of blockchain is immutability. Now, once a data is entered, you cannot delete it. So if somebody has put the data about that the container was not working or the air conditioning of the container was not working for 3 hours, which makes it suboptimal product, now nobody can change that data. So if I'm an end user or if I'm a food trader, I will be transparently able to see that this food is suboptimal. So I can make a decision either to discard it or rework the pricing if it falls within the contours of regulation and ensure there is a fair trade. The third is transparency. Everybody across the system knows when it was harvested, when it was packed, who did the quality assessment, whether the quality assessment was done or not, who shipped it, when did he ship, how long it was in container, who purchased it once it landed, who is the retailer. So when you put all these things visible to different stakeholders, the transparency ensures that people are more sure about safety of the food. And those who want to do wrong things would be deterred not to do those wrong things because it might compromise the food safety. And finally, the efficiency. The efficiency is one of the strongest pillar of application of blockchain in food value chains. If you are able to reduce the time of contracts, the paperwork, by 50 to 60%, you would have saved a lot of cost. Similarly, you can plan your logistics better. You can plan your retail sales plan better. You can make your pricing more lucrative because you know exactly when you'll be receiving a product, when, in what condition, with what certification. From certification to logistics to procurement, blockchain makes complete value chain very efficient. So what are the typical blockchain use cases when it comes to food and agriculture? One is farm gate to fork. So from the farmer who inputs data with the geotag, a quality assessor assesses that. So farmer starts a transaction, creates a transaction, validated by a quality assessor who assess the quantity, various parameters on quality. That data is accessed by the aggregator who receive produce from multiple farm gates. He creates batch. That batch information is again put across as a transaction on the blockchain. From there, different stages of trade happens. And finally, when the produce reaches the doorstep of the end user with a simple QR code, he can see end to end that which location the food was produced, what inputs were used in that, what quality was when it was harvested, what quality was it when it was retailed, and what quality when it is being traded within the value chain. Farm gate to fork also ensure that cost of logistics and people's intention to trust the food they are getting in their hand increases substantially, hence creating value for everyone across the value chain. The second immediate use case of blockchain in agriculture and food domain is cross-border trade in food. Food needs a lot of certification, from kosher to organic certification to sustainably grown palm. So there are a lot of certification depending on what type of commodity you're talking about. Then there is a huge paperwork when it comes to movement of containers from one country to another. Now, these cross-border trade documentation take days. Now, using blockchain, you can ensure that you reduce the paperwork and make it seamless. This ensures the shorter time to market for the products. When you reduce the time to consumer, you also reduce the losses which will happen post-harvest. And finally, the food certification itself is a big use case. So whether we want to certify a product as organic or we want to certify a product as responsibly grown palm, all of this can use blockchain to ensure that trust in the certificate being issued by these platforms are treated with utmost trust by everybody in the value chain, including the end user. Now, typically, where to blockchain? So you see that in agriculture value chain, there are multiple stakeholders, from input companies to output companies to financial institutions to NGOs to commodity buyers, insurance and risk mitigation. All of them can actually use blockchain intelligently for both the transactional data as well as farm data, and merging it with public data regarding the rules and regulation. The whole value chain can be made efficient, transparent, trusted, as well as profitable for each stakeholder. Now let's talk a little bit about my company. So Honeybee identifies opportunity and create offerings based on blockchain, which delivers value to your consumers, customers, and enable platform-based collaborative economics, which provides you competitive advantage. So we help companies who want to take path of blockchain by providing expertise in technology, providing insights, help them build robust applications, execute projects, and work as a platform player for them to create value for their end users. We work across multiple countries in Africa and Asia. In our network, we have worked with a lot of startups, AgTech players, multilateral agencies, as well as agribusinesses. So with that, I come to the end of this session of our Blockchain Masterclass. Thanks a lot for participating. And now we will be opening ourselves to questions and answers. You can follow us on LinkedIn, Facebook, and YouTube, and can also email to me directly. Thank you.